things I love about Sean is a very thundering voice. I'm very soft-spoken, so I'm going to try my best to speak up for you. But thanks be to God, who always leads us in triumph and manifests through us the sweet aroma of the knowledge of Him in every place. For we are a fragrance of Christ to God among those who are being saved and among those who are perishing. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 14 and 15. I'm here to talk to you tonight and continue the discussion that you started this week on wisdom for the home. Specifically tonight, I want to share the perspective that one of the wisest things we can do for the home is to leave the home. Now, I'm not talking about in an irresponsible way like a prodigal son going and leaving behind all your responsibilities, mortgage and family and everything. I'm talking about leaving your comfort zone and getting out into the world and preaching the gospel. That's what I mean by leaving the home. So I want you to imagine tonight that you're sitting on the port at Antioch. And I want you to come on a mission trip with me. You have Paul and Barnabas and John Mark. They're going on their first missionary journey, and they're looking to you, asking you to come with them. Would you go with them? Would you leave your home, safety and security of your home? Would you leave your children, your family, your friends, your church family back at home? Would you do that? I think a lot of us feel really comfortable at home. We feel really good about our home, don't we? It feels really good to get a warm and comforting feeling about your home and safety and security. And Proverbs 27:8 says, like a bird who wanders from her nest, so is a man who wanders from his home. But also we have a church home that we hear about in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. One that where if our worldly home was destroyed, we still have one in the heavens that's eternal. And we yearn for that home. This is our spiritual home, the church. And we feel so comfortable within our spiritual home, the church. And we come here, we get in the pattern that's been established for us of coming here on the Lord's Day and singing praises to the Lord and taking the Lord's Supper and hearing a message from His Word and doing Bible classes and going to potluck meals and coming on Wednesday nights and Sunday mornings. We feel very comfortable with our service within the church. And it's important. That's where we get our encouragement and our strength from. And we're commanded to do these things, and we should keep doing these things. The concern I have is that sometimes we get so comfortable in doing those things that we almost forget that that's not our only act of service that we're supposed to do. We're supposed to look beyond these four walls and these windows. We're supposed to get out there. And it's intimidating sometimes. It's challenging. You look out of your window and the safety and security of your home, and there's uncertainty out there. There's persecution. There's difficulty. And we just think about how comfortable it is in here. And sometimes we don't get out there and do things that make us feel uncomfortable that we need to do. Let me share a personal story with you. A couple weeks ago, I was at work, and well, actually, I was out of town. I was on vacation with the family. Got a text message that says, "You're going to Houston." So UPS, you know, we deliver a lot of packages in these major metro areas, and if a hurricane comes and shuts down the whole metropolitan area for a period of time, we get behind in packages, and they send UPSers out to go out and help. And I was so excited about this. Not necessarily for the idea of handling packages and delivering packages, but I wanted to actually go to a disaster zone and help with relief. I mean, I've heard of great works out there that are being done by the Churches of Christ, disaster relief, for example, and they go out and they deliver supplies in the community, and I wanted to be there to help out with that. I was really excited about it. So I went through my first week of work, found a congregation that seemed sound that I wanted to go worship at. I went into services, and everything felt great. You know, it was a great Bible study. I was very encouraged. It was a great lesson, and you know, it was very uplifting for me to be there. And then at the end, they made an announcement that said, "Yesterday we received a 53-foot trailer full of disaster relief supplies to distribute to local churches, or to local people in need in the community, and we need people to come sign up. Well, then I didn't feel as comfortable about it. Then I started to say, well, you know, it's really been a long week, and this is my day off. Maybe I should just go back to the hotel and relax a little bit. And, you know, going out and talking to strangers, I'm not feeling really social right now. I don't want to face the contradictions of teaching the scriptures and dealing with people socially, so I just go home and you know, I didn't have a big breakfast. There's a Tex-Mex place right down the street I heard really good. Maybe I should go there and just have lunch and get out of here. So as soon as they're done, I'm gonna cut out of here. That's what I'm telling myself in my head. Well, after service is let out, I went to my body's moving, my mind's telling me to get out there. I look on the sign-up sheet, and there are no slots for Sunday. I guess they're not working on Sunday. So I say, okay, I'll just pop jam and get out of here. Then an elder came up to me, and we were talking. I asked him about what their plans were for distributing the supplies. And he said, hold on a second. We're not distributing anything today, but let me go find someone for you. I have someone you want to talk to. I thought, great. This is a great opportunity for me to get out of here. It's your last chance to avoid doing work. What's happening? Something that seems so great and logical in the comfort of my own home seemed just crazy when it actually came time to do it. Why is that? Why do we get these thoughts sometimes? And we all get these negative thoughts and debilitating thoughts that prevent us from going out and doing service to the Lord. Why is that? Well, thanks be to God. They brought another UPS driver to me who happened to be in the church. And he said, you know what? I think you and I should go out today. We should deliver those supplies. We didn't have plans to. Let's go out and deliver those supplies. It's like, yeah, that's great. I want to go do that. And we did that. We got a bunch of other UPSers help. We loaded up trucks full of supplies and went out to the community and passed out supplies. People were so thankful. People were in great need. They lost everything. The church was glorified. We told people about the church. God was glorified. And it was a great thing. But just getting out of your comfort zone was so difficult for us sometimes. And when we think about us being here in the church building and not letting our light shine in the world, I think about Matthew chapter 5, verse 15. It says, nor is anyone light a lamp and put it on the lampstand, put it under a basket, but they put it on the shelf and gives light to all who are in the house. So how can we do this? What can we do to get over our fears and our selfish thoughts sometimes and get on that boat? Get out of our comfort zone, leave the home, and go out into the community or into another country and do work. How do we do that? Well, first thing I'm going to recommend tonight is that you realize that we're all missionaries, every single one of us, and that we have a personal way that we can serve the kingdom and fulfill our mission to the Lord. Second is, God gives us the tools we need. He gives us everything we need to go out and do this service. It's not us on our own. And third, we can do it. It's possible, but you need to give up on a daily basis your self-interest and your what feels right to you, and dedicate your life on a daily basis to service to the Lord. So as Deacon of Missions at Piedmont Road, I've thought about this a lot, and I've studied a lot, and had opportunities to speak a lot about what is mission work, what is our responsibility to do mission work, and what does the Bible have to say about it. And I've come to a conclusion that I think is kind of unique, and that is that the missions is for all of us. It's for every single one of us. And it's not about where. It could be near or it could be far. It's not about who. It could be any one of us. Sometimes we think in our mind that a missionary is reserved just to a few select people who are sometimes eccentric. And we send them overseas, give them money, and we think of them only occasionally in our bulletin or in prayers. When I read the Bible in the New American Standard Version, there's one instance of the word mission, and that is in the context of Acts chapter 11 and Acts chapter 12, when Paul and Barnabas decided to go to the church, back to the church in Jerusalem from Antioch, to assist with famine relief efforts. Now this was before Paul's first missionary journey. What we point his first missionary journey, he went on a mission to go to another church and help relieve the famine. And it's not something that's extremely far away. You know, it'd be akin to me going to Houston. So it's not about near or far. You know what the word is that's used there for mission? The Greek word is diakonia. Are you familiar with that word? We talk about the word for the office of deacons. And really what diakonia means is servant. It means minister. So here we are, we have a term that's used that when we decide to put on Christ in baptism, we decide to make a change in our life, repent of our old ways and our sins, and dedicate our life to service to Christ. We dedicated our life to putting our hands to the plow. We dedicated our lives to being servants. We dedicate our lives being ministers and missionaries. It's not reserved for a select few. Let's think about Ephesians chapter 4. And what is this service that we're supposed to engage in? Now, if you want to mark your Bibles, we'll be in Ephesians chapter 3 and 4, and Matthew chapters 9 and 10 for most of the lesson tonight. But I want us to consider Ephesians chapter 4, beginning in verse 7 and 8. But to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, it says, when he ascended on high, he led captive a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. Skipping down to verse 11. And he gave some as apostles, and some as prophets, and some as evangelists, and some as pastors and teachers, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of service, to the building up of the body of Christ. Now, who is he equipping for the work of service? Is that only just a select few? No, it says equipping the saints for the work of service. We're all being equipped for the work of service. Is that for just the local congregation? No, it's for the church. There's one church, and it's a global church. And so this tells me that we, as saints, all have a responsibility to build up the church, the one church, through service. Now, a similar passage, I think that was the one I opened up with, is 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 14 and 15. But thanks be to God who always leads us in triumph and manifests through us the sweet aroma of the knowledge of him in every place. Verse number 8 of Ephesians 4. Therefore, it says, when he ascended on high, he led captive a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. It's so clear and so logical that when Jesus ascended back into heaven and sat on the throne at the right hand of the Father, and he gave gifts to men, he gave responsibilities to his followers and his servants to proclaim the gospel and continue the work he started of growing the kingdom. Another thing we learn from this passage, I think, is that we're all going to do it in different ways. We all have different responsibilities, roles that we can play in building up the church. In this passage, it says some are given as apostles, some are as pastors, some as teachers, some as evangelists. It doesn't say some as missionaries. It's not a unique role. But we all have different roles. Now, think about our Lord even. And when he was here on earth, he was the builder of the kingdom. But he had a very specific mission, when he was here on earth. Remember, in the Bible says, in Matthew chapter 4, verse 17, that Jesus began to preach and say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. In Matthew chapter 15, we read an interesting story about a Syrophoenician woman who's basically not Jewish, a heathen. And she approaches Jesus because her daughter is sick. In verse 21, Jesus went away from there and withdrew into the district Tyre and Sidon. And a Canaanite woman from that region came out and began to cry out, saying, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is cruelly demon-possessed." But he did not answer her a word, and his disciples came and implored him, saying, "Send her away, because she keeps shouting at us." But he answered and said, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and began to bow down before him, saying, "Lord, help me." And he answered and said, "It is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs." But she said, "Yes, Lord, but even the dogs feed on the crumbs which fall from their master's table." Then Jesus said to her, "O woman, your faith is great. It shall be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed at once. I do not believe that the main message of this passage is about having specific roles or missions. It's about the faith of the Phoenician woman. And Jesus healed her, but at first he ignored her and said, "It's not right for, this is not what I came here for." Even Jesus had a very focused mission. I think that's one thing we can take from it. Paul, in Ephesians chapter 3, he talks about how he came by the grace of God to deliver the message to the Gentiles. That was his specific mission. Now, we can all have different ways that we fulfill this mission. And we're not like the apostles or Jesus who had direct revelation from the Holy Spirit. No, we have to make our own decisions about how we're going to work in the church. And maybe the elders would give us some direction in that. But it's okay for us to consider the strengths that we've been provided and fulfill our mission in different ways. There's some of us who may be very adventurous and enjoy traveling and enjoy different cultures and speak different languages. That person would probably be very good at going overseas and doing foreign mission work. There's some people that are really dynamic and great public speakers, and they're probably really good from teaching from the pulpit. There's some of us that are really good with personal one-on-one conversations. They're good people. I'm not great at that personally, at having one-on-one conversations, but some people are very social. They're going to be very good at one-on-one evangelism. And I'd be remiss if I didn't mention that the greatest support that I receive to do foreign mission work is from my wife. There's no way I could do some of the work that I do without her loving support. She takes care of the home. She takes care of the children. She does a lot of great work to support my work to be out in the field. And then how about the kids? How important is it that we raise faithful children to the Lord? You know how many times have you heard somebody say, "Well, why do you believe that?" "Well, it's because it's what my parents believed." And you know how hard it is to persuade people differently? So do you know how important it is to raise our children with the correct knowledge of the Word and raise them in the church faithfully? What kind of impact that's going to have down the road in their life? So there's so many ways that we can fulfill this mission of building up the church. But the point is that we're all needing to do it. We all may do it in different ways, but we all need to do it, and we all need to be participants in it. Another thing I observe from scriptures is the idea that the workers were dynamic. They were mobile. So what you do today may not be what you do next year. What you did when you were a first new Christian is not necessarily what you're going to do when you're a mature Christian. So we have to grow and mature and challenge ourselves in how we're serving the Lord and ministering to the kingdom. And we have to be willing to be mobile. That's another thing we observe about Jesus and the apostles, is they went from place to place to place. And I'm not implying that it necessarily means mobility in terms of jumping around town to town all the time. But we should be willing to consider what our area of ministry is, how we're serving the kingdom and growing the kingdom. Is it working? Do we need to do something else to be more effective at growing the kingdom? We need to be willing to be dynamic and not stuck in our comfort zone all the time. So one of the more difficult parts of this, I think most of us would agree, is while we're comfortable with our areas of strength, we know what we do good, we're not as comfortable with the most important part of building up the church, and that's evangelism. While we all feel great about going out and doing our works of service, sometimes that's a lot easier. We don't feel as comfortable doing evangelism. And one of the things that I try to emphasize with my elders and with the deacons and the different works and what our approach is for supporting different mission works out in the field is that we need to consider works that have a balance, and a balance of service and evangelism. There are some missionaries that will focus almost entirely on evangelism, but not do any kind of service. And they're not as effective as missionaries that would do a little bit of both. And some, on the other hand, will focus a lot more on service. We can learn from Jesus in this regard. In Matthew chapter 9, and we're all familiar with the passage that where Jesus said, you know, look at the fields that are ripe for harvest, but the laborers are few. Just before that, it talks about how Jesus was going through all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every kind of sickness and disease. So by showing our love and demonstrating our love, we're opening up our people's minds. By performing those acts of service and kindness, we're opening up people's minds. But we need to take advantage of that. We can't just go out and do great works in the community or for local communities and not follow up with strong, firm, bold gospel preaching. That's just not going to be nearly as effective. One missionary I was asked to consider, he's opening an orphanage. He's developing an orphanage. And I told the elders I would go out there and take a look at it. So I traveled out there in conjunction with another trip. And I looked, I'm not going to tell you the details in case you know the person. I'm just going to share my opinion. You may not have the same opinion. But kind of scouting out the work, my heart was really touched. They're really children in this community that are so poor. I mean, they lack basic things, no shoes. We went out to the community, tons of children everywhere, dirty, and but you couldn't see any adults. There were maybe a few adults that looked, I mean, they were out off in the corner, you're thinking, are they drunk, or what are they doing? But there are kids everywhere, obviously really neglected kids. And maybe their parents are the only way they can provide sustenance, to be out working all day. And then we talk about the plans for the orphanage, and it's very grand vision. Maybe 8 orphanage homes, a garden, a chapel, a school. They were going to bring in maybe 100 kids. Each house would have 3 parents. I mean, it was just great. My heart was touched. But my logical side was not quite there yet. I asked, what are your plans to, you know, glorify God and evangelize these children as part of this? Well, we're going to build such, and maybe 3 years from now we'll hire a preacher. And I wasn't too happy with the priorities on this. And then, what are we going to do to ensure that it's faithful gospel preaching, true to the Word of God? How are we going to ensure? Even in that regard, I wasn't wasn't quite satisfied with his answer. So at the end of the day, I had to make a recommendation, even though it's a great work of service. It would have done great work in the community. I wasn't sure it was going to bring glory to God in the right way. I'm not sure that even if souls are converted, they're converted in the right way. And so it was just was not acceptable to me. I think that most congregations understand that. We wouldn't support missionaries overseas that aren't practicing firm, bold gospel, true gospel preaching. We wouldn't do that. But when we think about our own personal work of service, do we have that right balance of service and evangelism in our lives? I know that we don't at Piedmont Road. I know that we find difficulty with that sometimes. We think about all the things we're doing for the community, and there's not really a good plan to actually go out and talk to people about the Bible. It's not, and you can't divorce the two. You can't say that people are just going to absorb the truth by osmosis. It doesn't work that way. They need to be told. How will they call on the Lord if they don't believe? How will they believe if they're not taught? And we need to go out there and teach. Evangelism needs to be as much a component of mission work as anything else. So do you know where we can observe this in practice? Where can we observe this kind of spirit of strong evangelistic spirit out in the world? Like if you wanted to know, I want to be a great evangelist and I want to go learn how to do that. Where do you think you can go to learn how to do that? Well, I can tell you from experience that the best place to go learn how to have an evangelistic experience is to go to another country that's poorer than we are and watch the brethren there go out and evangelize. Let me tell you what, this may surprise you, but our brethren in other poorer countries are better at mission work than we are. You say, how is that possible? We're spending all this money, we're sending Americans over there because they need us. There's no way that they would be able to be great Christians unless we went over there and told them the truth. There's no other way they're going to get it. And we think that. But then, and that's partially true, we need to go there and we need to do that. We need to spend that money. But then you go there, and I'm telling you that a missionary that goes over there, even though the most mature, educated missionary here from the States, will go over there and learn as much, if not more, from the local Christians than he will teach them. Why is that? Let me tell you. I went over to the Philippines this year, and it was a beautiful, very beautiful thing, an edifying and encouraging thing. We had a medical mission campaign, and we had every kind of medical care you could think of. We had blood pressure and doctor checkups, and we're removing teeth, not me personally, but doctors, certified dentists were there doing their work. Prescription drugs, eyeglasses. We were great, offering great service to the community. But you know what? People did not get an ounce of medical care. Not zero attention on the physical side until every single person had to sit down and do a Bible study or have a spiritual conversation about where they stand spiritually, what the Bible has to say about that, with one of the brethren there. That's not something I told them there or the American missionaries suggested. It was just, yeah, obviously, why wouldn't we do that? Before we give them anything to care for their physical needs, we want to prioritize their spiritual needs and tell them from the scriptures what they need to do to be saved. Such a great spirit. You know how much difficulty, we do a backpack supply giveaway at Piedmont Road. And you know how much difficulty I'm having trying to convince people that same concept that we need to do Bible studies with people. In other words, don't just give them a backpack and send them on their way. We should do Bible studies for them first. You know how much difficulty I'm having trying to persuade people that's the right thing to do? Oh, someone said this. We don't want to inconvenience people. People are coming for the backpack. We want to make sure we give them the backpack. They won't want to hear the Bible. Well, yeah, that's true. Then maybe we should give them a backpack. The priority needs to be on evangelism. And they understand that in some of these other countries that we perceive as being spiritually weak. They're very strong in this regard. And it was beautiful. We all got like bright green shirts, kind of like that shirt back there. And it said Churches of Christ. And right around lunchtime, things start to slow down. It's really hot. People go back to their homes. You know, people weren't coming for the medical attention anymore. We were hungry. It was heat of the day. And just, it was very strange. Like, all of a sudden, everyone got up. All the brothers and sisters there in the Philippines got up and said, all right, it's time to go out. I mean, it was like there's no coordination. It's the next logical thing for us to do. We got to go out and get more people to come. The crowd's dying now. We need to go out and follow up with these people. We got their names and addresses. Let's go follow up with them right now. And it was like an army of green shirts going down the street. And then I'm just without any coordination. And they were excited about it. There were young people. There were old people that could hardly walk. There were men and women. And they're just going down the street. And then all of a sudden, you just see everyone fanning out to go to different homes and talk to people. Do they get rejection like we do? Absolutely. Absolutely. I'm not sure anyone came back as a result of that effort. But they were not deterred. They have such an extraordinary attitude and spirit for evangelism. I learned so much when I go overseas and witness the attitude and the sincerity of our brothers and sisters overseas. This is part of the reason why I've chosen foreign mission work is my area of ministry, the area I want to focus on. I wonder why that is. Why do some of the brethren in these poorer countries that we perceive need us and are teaching so much more, why is it that they actually have a great spirit for evangelism? Well, I think it gets to the fact that kind of what James was saying in chapter 2, that God chose the poor of this world for the kingdom. And there's poor in the physical sense. They don't have a lot. And there's poor in the spiritual sense that they're so oppressed in so many different ways in some of these poor countries. The brethren in India, I'm planning to go there next year. I've talked a lot with a missionary there. I mean, someone just got killed by a mob, a Christian, in open streets for practicing his faith. They constantly live in danger of persecution. When he came to speak to us, he said, Brother Scott, can you make sure this is not stream live? Why wouldn't you want it stream live? He said, because the radical Hindu groups monitor the transmissions of churches, and they have his name, and they will monitor internet transmissions. This is how organized the radical Hindu mobs are in India. That they monitor internet transmissions, and if they identify certain Christians and they know them, they will target them and kill them. I went to Honduras a couple years back, and I got to do a youth camp there. And this is in Tegucigalpa. It's like one of the highest murder rates in the whole world. Even during the Iraq War, it had one of the highest murder rates in the whole world because of the gangs. And if you're a teenager in Tegucigalpa, if you're a female, you have certain threats that you would have from the gangs. If you're a male, you only have two choices. You're either going to be a drug addict or you're going to join the gang. They make sure that every teenage boy is indoctrinated. And, no, I'm sorry, you have more than two choices. You could come to the United States, you could immigrate illegally, or you could get killed. If you're a teenage boy in Tegucigalpa, Honduras, those are your choices, or so it seems. But doing this youth camp in this place and seeing the youth there was such an encouragement to me. They had such an extraordinary spirit, such a great attitude, such a zeal for the Lord. Why is it? How is it that we can face such difficult circumstances? Brethren throughout the world can face such difficult circumstances, but be so strong in the Lord. How is that? God chose the poor of the world. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. I think it has to do with the fact that if you're not concerned with the things of the world, then you're going to be a better servant. If you have no hope in this world, you're going to be a better servant for the Lord. That's why I think we have so much to learn from our brethren in overseas. And I've chosen that as my area that's important to me. When I was a couple years ago, I guess right around the time I met Sean, I was kind of an inflection point in my life. I was changing careers. I was moving cities. New kid, you know, an evaluation point. I was a Christian, faithful Christian. I knew I wanted to dedicate my life to the Lord, but you know, how do I want to serve the Lord? Do I want to be an elder? Do I want to go to preaching school and be a preacher? How do I want to do it? And at the same time, I was traveling to Bolivia for business, not missions. And I went to worship at a local congregation there. And I met one of the elders. This is one of the only congregations I've been to internationally that has an elder. And I met one of the elders, and he raved and raved, couldn't stop talking about how happy he was that one of the brethren in the United States helped him out, how much support he got from the United States. And I said, wait, what do you mean? He said, well, not too long ago, I mean, we had this building. It was a grand building. It's probably, for a foreign country, this is big, but it's about the size of this auditorium. And it was a very prominent area of Santa Cruz, Bolivia, which is a big, big town. So it is a great location. Great building. They had it for free at one point because the owner just generously allowed them to worship there. And over time, they built up the congregation. It was maybe about 50, 60 strong. It was a good congregation. And he said, but you know what happened? The owner passed away. The owner passed away, and they were about to lose the building. The new owner required them, said, you have like a month to get out of here. You can't worship here anymore, or pay $75,000 and buy the building. He's like, I didn't know what to do. We have no place to worship. This is the middle of a prominent area of town. There's no other way we can find another property that's going to be economical for us. I was noticing your contributions. The same congregation about this size, you get about $2,000 on a Sunday. I don't know if that's typical or not, but let's just say you get $2,000 on a Sunday. That congregation, I'm just going to guess because I've heard what other congregations get, they probably get $40 on a Sunday. $40 does not leave you much to do anything with a building. That shouldn't be your priority anyways. Your priority should be benevolence. And going out and giving, that's where you spend your $40 a week. They don't have enough money to worry about a building. But he said, you know, I called a brother that helped establish. I called the congregation to help establish us over 20 years ago. We've since lost contact. We've grown up. We haven't had any contact, but I called them and called one of the elders and said, brother, what can we do? What do you suggest we do? There's no way we can find another place to worship. We have a month. We need some. So give me a week. I'll get back to you. So he got back to him and said, well, I've got good news. We're going to pay the $75,000 to buy the building. And I thought, wow, what generosity. And we can do that in America because we have lots of money in our congregations. And we're wealthy. We are. You may not feel wealthy personally, but when you compare us to others, the standards of other countries, we're so wealthy. We can do that. I thought, wow, that's what I want to do. He was so happy. That's what I want to do. I want to be generous to congregations overseas that without our support, they're going to be struggling. They need our help. And frankly, they need our money a lot of times. They don't learn much from us from an evangelistic perspective. but they need our help. They need our support and our care and our love. And you know what? I took the Lord's Supper at the exact same time you were here taking the Lord's Supper. They had this exact same pattern of worship that you have here, singing songs, and it's probably the exact same order. They just spoke a different language. They were in another part of the world. They're brothers and sisters. I don't read anything in the Bible that says we need to focus on our specific congregation. I want to go help other people who need it more than we do. I know we have a lot of needs. We do. And we need to minister to our own flock. But that's what I decided I wanted to focus on, was other countries who have a strong evangelistic spirit and who really need the support of the U.S. churches. That's where I've decided to focus my time. It's tough. There may not be, in your mind, you may be discouraged by going out and doing personal evangelism or going out to the mission field and doing mission work. And you may be discouraged by certain things. One might be that, hey, I'm just not a good communicator. I'm just not good at talking with people. Paul's said himself to the church at Corinth that he was not an excellent speaker. He was one of the least of the apostles in his ability to speak. It could be you don't feel like you're complete in your knowledge of Scripture. We all feel that way. In fact, I was thinking about this. I never thought about this before. The apostles, even Peter, after the ascension of Christ and receiving the Holy Spirit and going out and preaching the gospel of the Lord, he still didn't have a full comprehension of everything. He only had part of it. He didn't realize that I need to go preach to Gentiles too. That's the gospel's for them too. He didn't understand that at first. Even the apostles did not have complete knowledge. We're not required to have complete knowledge of everything. We're not required to have a Bible degree. We're not required to be beyond a certain age and experience. We just need to go and proclaim the good news. At the minimum, just tell people what you saw from scriptures that made you change your life. The minimum you could do that. So it's knowledge sometimes I feel like that it discourages. I really hope, the worst of all, I really hope that we're not choosing not to evangelize or do mission work because our love is grown cold. That is the worst. In Matthew chapter 10, verses 32 and 33, it says, "Therefore, whoever confesses me before men, I will also confess him before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will deny him before my Father who is in heaven." Now, we think of that verse sometimes, that passage, as being one defining act, one moment in the process for salvation. Hear, believe, repent, confess, be baptized. And we're confessing at one particular moment in our path to salvation. I don't think that's what that is talking about. I think that, well, the context here is Jesus sending his disciples out into the world to minister. He's saying, when you're out there and you're ministering, you need to confess me. Don't deny me. Think about Acts chapter 2, verse 25 through 27. This is Peter on the day of Pentecost reflecting back on what David said of the Messiah. David being a prophet, being able to foresee the coming Messiah. So for David says of him, "I saw the Lord always in my presence, for he is in my right hand, so that I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart was glad and my tongue exalted. Moreover, my flesh will also live in hope, because you will not abandon my soul to Hades. I love the cool, basic logic there. Therefore, my heart was glad, and my tongue exalted. It's a simple if-then statement. If your heart is glad and you love the Lord, then your tongue will exalt. If your tongue's not exalting, do you love the Lord? If you love the Lord and you're happy for what he did for you, you appreciate his presence, you appreciate the fact that he died and conquered death on your behalf, then your tongue will exalt. I really hope that that's not what's preventing us. And one of my goals in doing mission work is also to enlist more people. I want to get more people involved in foreign mission work. I know not everyone's going to be able to do that, but I want as many people. I took a 70-year-old. But he came with me to Philippines. 72-year-old man. He's a cancer survivor. Lost his wife. Faced a very tough hardship. But he came with us to the Philippines, had just as much energy as anyone else because he was working for the Lord, and he contributed, I'm going to say he contributed more than anyone else, more than any of us younger guys. He sat down with the local Filipinos and he did Bible studies, and he was very adamant and passionate about evangelism. 72-year-old man. But I hear excuses. I hear excuses a lot. I would love to do missions work, but I hear that a lot. I would love to do missions work, but things aren't really good at home right now. Finances are a little tight. I don't think I can swing it. I would love to do missions work, but my wife or my husband's not comfortable with me going out and putting my life in harm's way.